So this, I think now, DV, with this, we seem to have got a complete understanding, right? From the need
end to end,
to actually employee journey. Do you think this is a good time to go back and show Varsha what we did?
Yeah, I think so. We should show her what we did. We have only focused on the channel effectiveness part of the whole thing. I think we should show her what we did. Yes.
First, you the data that you had given us, GV and I did a little bit of work. So if you're okay, we'd like to share some of our results with you.
Yes, please.
Okay. So one of the first things that we looked at was we wanted to see what was the skill distribution dashboard. Okay. So looks like people wanted, Madhuri wanted four different skills: Java basics, object-oriented programming, advanced libraries, and hands-on programming. And we looked at people from five ratings, which had come out of the assessment: unsatisfactory, average, good, very good, and exceptional. Does this graph make sense to you? What do you think?
So one of the things that we typically notice is that, yes, there would be some amount of bell curve. And you will find a lot of people within the good and very good, very few within the exceptional. Now, once Madhuri sees this, what she would want to know typically is what's the kind of weighted average across all of them. Or she might say, okay, people with, say, object-oriented programming, if they are exceptional, do they also have a very good in the other three? So she might put her own conditions on what's the kind of shortlisting, because this is what she will use for shortlisting candidates, right? And she will say, okay, this is the kind of profile that I have, talent profile. This is what seems to be coming out. This is the kind of skill sets that is absolutely required to me. So they would be, or, you know, what she would want to see is a secondary level, you know, slightly deeper dive into what is it that she wants and how it really fits with her requirements. So that is something else that you would like to look at. But this does make sense.
So one interesting word you used there, bell curve. What does that mean?
So bell curve typically comes from the more from statistics, okay? And the basic tenet under a bell curve is that if there is performance, or if you look at a statistically valid set of people on one particular characteristic, you will get a normal distribution. And that normal distribution is considered to be the bell curve. Okay,
so this curve is a bell curve because between unsatisfactory average, somewhere in the middle, good, you're getting a peak there.
Yeah, this is a bunch of people, you know, in good, if you look at it that way.
Yeah,
and unsatisfactory is a smaller part, and so is exceptional.
Okay.
So it is shaped like a bell, is it? If I look at it 90 degrees rotated, it will look like a bell.
It will look like a bell curve. So you will have your sigma 1, 2, 3 and a sigma 1, 2, 3 on both the positive and the negative sides. Okay, so while it might work in skills, while it might work in understanding, let me just put a caveat out here. Sometimes people say that this might not be very relevant for performance, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you might get set of people who have a bell curve kind of a rating on skills, which is fine. Some people will do better, some people will not do better. It might not always be a bell curve. It might be, or it could be a bell curve which is shifted to the left or shifted to the right, depending on what is the skill you're testing. So you use this with a lot of, you need to have a lot of background to make sure that you're using the correct metrics out here. So if Madhuri were to look at it and say that, I'm not very happy with the candidates that we have got, because, you know, there are not too many very good and exceptional people, then she would typically have some historical evidence saying that for this particular position, I have seen many more percentage of people who have, you know, done very good or exceptional. Okay, so I'll give a very simple example of how this gets translated into practical reality, right? So when you are going and selecting freshers from campus, a recruitment manager would typically say, or organizations would say, I need a base CGPA of 8 before I hire. Now that if you see it, typically might not be an average rating, might be an average rating. And then you basically calibrate, saying where does 8 come? If 8 is the average rating, then that's okay. But if I'm paying top bucks, then I might say my CGPA requirement is 9. And then you're really not looking at 2 sigma, you're looking at 3 sigma.
Okay. So where in the distribution curve you will take cutoff?
Yes.
What is your cutoff? Yeah.
Okay. What will be your cutoff? And that is something that the skill distribution dashboard would.
Because if you cut off too sharply, you will not get anybody. Yeah. If you cut off too little, then you are not getting the best people.
Exactly. Yeah? Okay. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The next dashboard, Varsha, like GV mentioned, we looked at channel effectiveness. And we looked at 4 parameters to measure channel effectiveness, like you had guided us. One was time to complete the application. The second was candidate experience. The third was offer acceptance rate. And the fourth was cost of recruitment and hiring. And we looked at 4 different channels: direct website, employee referral, third party, and LinkedIn.
Okay.
So does this chart make sense to you?
Yes, absolutely. So one of the things that we do see is that from an effectiveness of channel perspective, into making sure that you get the best candidates and the best candidates perform, organizations do see third party as being very, very high, but the costs are, of course, you know, they go in tandem with their effectiveness. What is becoming very popular are LinkedIn kind of job portals, but the effectiveness is still not that easily gauged, right? So the cost might be a little low, but you may not end up getting the number of resumes that you want, because there is no pull factor. It's you're just pushing things out and you don't know. It's like you're throwing out a net, wide net, and you don't know whether you're going to get anything in it or not. While a third party approach is a much more focused approach, typically used for project leaders and above, or for extremely hot skills.
I see. So we did track combining these 4 parameters, and this is how it totally came up. Okay, and we were actually, remember GV, we were discussing, at least I was personally a little surprised that employee referral was somewhat low. Of course, you did mention that third party is a very good choice, but it's an expensive choice.
Yes. Now, employee referral, if you look at it, this is a very good percentage.
Right? Nice.
You might think that the numbers are low, but even if you get 1 out of 15 from an employee referral, it's a very good find. Typically, organizations prefer that, because if you're referring a friend, the chances of a person being recruited through employee referral, of that person staying longer, of that person being a better cultural fit, are much higher. Okay, so you might get lesser people. Yeah, because you actually have your employees doing your selling for you. It's not a third party person who is only talking about designation, who's talking about salary, who's talking about on-site opportunities. You actually have people saying that, hey, this is a great place to work in. I learned a lot. you know, I'm very comfortable in this. It's a very ethical place. So there are softer factors that come through in an employee referral, better stickiness than what you get in third party. It's just that third party is much more efficient, you know, quantitatively than qualitative.
The other thing we noticed, Varsha, is that employee referral and LinkedIn, they seem to have similar, the correlation between those two channels was very high. Want to comment on that? I mean,
so the correlation actually is on two different factors. The employee referral is, to a certain extent, the brand value that the organization is pushing through its employees. What you see on LinkedIn can come from two sources. One is, of course, the brand value. And I'm not just talking about LinkedIn. I'm talking about any job portals. One is, of course, what is the brand value that the organization has as an employer, right? So you have organizations that are best employers, or that are dream job, organizations that have dream jobs. That will be one of the pull factors on social media. The other will be LinkedIn itself will allow you to create a greater push, within the people that you're looking for. So again, it's a little bit of a shotgun scattergun approach to that extent, LinkedIn. And therefore, the numbers might end up being very similar. Again, it's a little bit of a softer aspect. It's the brand of the organization that carries it.
So GV,
you see with direct website also.
Mm-hmm. So GV, when we were discussing, remember we thought that LinkedIn was basically friends of friends and friends
of friends. Very similar to, correct.
But it also seems like LinkedIn or sites like LinkedIn are also a little bit of advertisement sites. That's I think what I understood from what Varsha was saying.
Yeah, so somebody like Ritesh will have to pay a job portal, right? To push their... I don't know if you've seen, all these job portals will have one column that says, jobs that you're interested in. Because they will ask you to put out some keywords and say that, okay, these are the ones that I'm interested in. And they will give you a list of jobs that they think are good. Obviously, the placement of, say tech enterprises jobs in that particular bulletin that I get, if there are matching keywords, will depend on, what's the kind of deal that Ritesh has struck with LinkedIn.
And that is how LinkedIn makes money.
That's how LinkedIn makes money.
Third party, but a little bit like my employee referral.
Yeah. So LinkedIn has something called, of course, a premium login where candidates can themselves choose to become premium, or it has a recruitment or an organizational login, which allows you to post job postings, which allows you to look at people's candidates, which allows you a certain number of LinkedIn emails. Right. So there are different business models that work on any of the job portals. As I said, it's not just LinkedIn. Any other job portals also would have similar such revenue models.
Okay.
They're basically creating a marketplace and leveraging that. So one of the things, just going back to the earlier one, one of the things that that you would also want to look at when you're looking at channelized candidate is how long it took to hire these. Which one was the quickest? Did this happen over a year? So what's the period? We also give you a better sense of, for which positions can I depend on which channel.
And maybe that was not some analysis that we did, right?
We did not do position-wise analysis.
No.
I think the data is weak for positions. I think, project lead, you could have done it for team members separately and project leaders separately. Yeah.
You'd also need to do a time, saying that what is the time that it takes for people to move from one level of the funnel to the other funnel. you know, to the next step in the funnel.
But that data was not available, right? We didn't get that data.
Should have been there. There would have been dates saying what time, what date was the position indented. What date was, did this candidate profile come in? What date did the interview happen? All of the data would typically be there. And typically it's very normal for organizations to track this, because for a recruitment team, the turnaround time, what we call TAT, is very, very important.
Okay. Maybe an assignment to be given to students to work on.